Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you to today's webinar organized by the International Policy Center for Inclusive Growth and UNICEF Regional Office for the Middle East and North Africa Region. And I am Ana Carolina, I will be your moderator for today. And I would like to welcome you all to this very critical discussion on the shock-responsive social protection. So today we'll be discussing the role of national social protection systems in responding to shocks and supporting the populations to be resilient throughout emergency situations. I will start by presenting this quite impressive team of panelists for today. We have just here with me, Raquel Tebaldi. Raquel, if you can just take that, please. Raquel, as a researcher here at IPC since 2015, she's the author of a study that will be very soon launched on shock responses to social protection in the MENA region. And she also worked before at the platform socialprotection.org. And she has been involved in many projects regarding social protection, not only in the Middle East, but also in Africa. She's also an emerging expert on the gender area and has been working with child-sensitive social protection. The second presentation will be delivered by Sara Nyanti and Kweyu, who are now working in the Yemen Emergency Cash Transfer Program, also led by UNICEF. Sara is today the team leader for the program. She has a very distinguished experience within the United Nations. She has worked with before in crisis situations, such as in the Nigeria national response to Ebola. Betty, who will be presenting with Sara, she also has an extensive experience with more than 10 years experience in cash transfer programming. And she also has worked before with UNICEF and international NGOs in many countries. So before Yemen, she was working in the Philippines, Lebanon, Palestine, among other countries. And the third presentation, last but not least, we have our colleague from UNICEF Jordan, Mr. Manuel Pumarol, who is a senior social policy expert in social protection and has also worked in the fields in many other countries, especially in Latin America, where he has worked in the directions of operations in the national program in the Dominican Republic. So Manuel is a doctor in medicine and has worked before in many international agencies, not only UNICEF, but also World Bank, UNDP, among many others. So very briefly about myself, I am Ana Machado. I've been working here at IPC for 3 years now as a researcher. I am part of the team working with UNICEF, Menado, on child-sensitive social protection in the region. And as part of this major project, I would like to introduce you some of the knowledge products we've been working along these last 2 years. If you can, yes, go to next. So among this, the products of this major project, we have 4 studies. So one on child responsive social protection that will be launched soon, 2 that have been already launched. Those are an overview of social protection in the MENA region through a child and equity lens. The second one on the legal frameworks of social protection. We also have an online community, which I invite you all to participate and join us in further discussions. The online community has over 50 experts from UNICEF, from government, and also academia, along all the region of MENA, and also other countries and people interested on the topic. So after this webinar too, we will be releasing the links on the platform, and all the accessible links will be available on the OC, on the online community. So you're all very welcome to participate actually today. So I encourage you all to interact with us along the presentations. Each of them will not pass 15 minutes because we want to have a Q&A session at the end. And I will be moderating the questions. I do my best to to bring up the main relevant and also try to simulate some of the questions that might be close to one to another. And you can always address them on the chat box and on the questions box. And I just kindly ask you to always identify yourselves, so your name, the country, and to whom the question is being addressed. So thank you very much. And I will now invite Raquel Tebaldi to start the presentation.
Thank you. I think it's the next one. You still need to connect right here.
And the other. Thank you. So thank you, Anna, and thank you everyone for joining today. As she mentioned, I'll be presenting an overview of an upcoming study on shock response of social protection in the MENA region. Firstly, I'll just go over some points on how social protection systems are typically challenged by various crisis situations. So conflict and institutional fragility typically leads to impacts in terms of which actors can be involved, particularly if government itself is party to the conflict. And also if the situation leads to large-scale displacement, this can have a big toll in terms of data accuracy of these existing systems. In terms of economic crisis, a lot of the literature dealing with the 2008 global crisis saw that it was challenging to start programs from scratch amid a crisis, and saw that countries fared better when they had already well-established systems that could expand horizontally, that is, absorb new beneficiaries into the systems. And also a challenge in this situation typically is safeguarding government expenditures on key areas, including social protection. Moving to the risks imposed by climate change and natural disasters, the challenges revolve around embedding knowledge of climate risks into programming so as not to promote maladaptive strategies, but also reinforcing the infrastructure available and building capacity for providing immediate support. Next slide, please. So, zooming in the MENA region, the index for risk management 2019 results are presented in this slide here for the MENA countries. As you can see, there are 7 countries rated as either high or very high risk. And among these, the human risk component of the sub-index related to hazard and exposure is the most prominent one in general. And also, when we look at the sub-index related to the lack of coping capacity, we see that institutional gaps are rather prominent, as opposed to infrastructure ones in general. Next slide, please. So, the study's research questions revolve around what are the key considerations for building resilience and the shock responsiveness of national social protection systems in the region, and providing a general assessment of how child-sensitive social protection systems, how are they equipped to face these shocks. The study includes 8 case studies, including Egypt, Iraq, Jordan, Lebanon, Palestine, Sudan, Syria, and Yemen. So it's important to mention that the study drew heavily from many studies that have been recently published on shock responsive social protection, including the ones by Oxford Policy Management on their broad project on shock responsive social protection systems. So shock responsiveness relates to a system's capacity to address covariate shocks, and this in turn relates to many attributes such as the system's level of maturity itself, also the fiscal space and policy frameworks that are available, the coordination and preparedness mechanisms, the targeting and management information systems that are available, delivery mechanisms, and the implementation capacities. So So in this study, the criteria we used in the assessment related to fiscal space was basically trying to understand what were the trends in terms of expenditure and source of funding, as well as if there were any contingency or emergency funding available, but also looking at the policy frameworks and if the national social protection and disaster management strategies had any linkages. Moreover, in terms of coordination and preparedness, we were looking at what the mechanisms are and if there are any emergency preparedness measures embedded in them. In terms of targeting, the point of this criteria here was to understand the scope, the scale, in terms of coverage of the existing programs, but also if there were any considerations of particularly vulnerable groups and vulnerability to shocks in the selection processes. In terms of the management information systems, we looked at information available on the databases to understand the coverage and if it included non-beneficiaries as well, and also any reports that were available in terms of data accuracy, quality, and other characteristics. So in terms of delivery mechanisms, we were also trying to outline what's the potential for scalability, available in the existing mechanisms, and implementation capacities and monitoring and evaluation. We're just basically trying to understand what's in place and if there are any gaps in these processes. So just moving on to the main findings, in terms of fiscal space and policy frameworks, we found that emergency funds are still uncommon, and the cases had a broad variety in terms of their institutionalization of the social protection system. So some don't yet rely on a comprehensive social protection policy or strategy, and others have programs quite embedded in law, so it's a broad range of cases in these terms. We found that emergency preparedness measures are lacking in general, and where disaster management and climate adaptation strategies exist, they in general don't make explicit links to social protection systems. The information we found on beneficiary databases is that they do tend to include both beneficiaries and non-beneficiaries, some including some even with large waiting lists of potential beneficiaries that would be prioritized in a potential scale-up. But it's important to highlight that the lack of comprehensive national social registries in the region is a key challenge for improving the shock responsiveness of the systems, though there is a move towards these in some countries. In terms of delivery mechanisms, there is a variety of mechanisms across cases, including electronic payments, payments through post offices, and an emerging interest in mobile payments as well. An important point, though, is that we found in some cases there might be payment timeliness issues. So some delays were spotted in some cases, but this is not necessarily due to the delivery mechanisms themselves, but rather to fiscal disbursement issues. So this is a point for further investigation in these cases. In terms of implementation capacities, we found some challenges in some cases regarding staff's precarious situations due to late payments of their salaries, or lack of compensation for expenses incurred during their work. Finally, in terms of monitoring and evaluation, we found that across cases, the systems are not so robust, and this leads to important gaps in terms of evidence-based policy making. So next slide, please. Sorry about that. You can please just open all the points. There are many points, thanks. I'm back. Yeah, sorry. sorry. So in terms of the conclusions and recommendations, investments in preparedness and coordination is needed to enhance the resilience and responsiveness of the systems. So for countries that still do not rely on a broad social protection strategy, it's important to align the sector internally, and this should be a first priority, but also those that have more advanced strategies in place and laws. It's important to also ensure the necessary flexibility if the systems are to act in shock response. On the point of social registries, it's really important to expand the coverage of the existing systems to all poor and near poor vulnerable people, as well as carrying out regular data assessments to understand the quality of it during times of stability. In terms of ensuring the scalability of payment systems, some recommendations are to map potential alternative service providers, as well as having contingency agreements with them, and investing in technology where this is needed to facilitate the payment processes. In terms of funding, of course, it's important to secure funding not only for regular social protection programming, but also contingency funding for a potential shock response. And in terms of monitoring and evaluation, these systems are rather challenging in the region, so it's important to invest in them so that policy making can be more evidence-based. And a final point on implementation capacities, I would just like to stress that it's crucial that the workers are valued and incentivized. So this might include offering more stable and well-compensated contracts, such as those obtained through civil service. But also, if staff is required to act on shock response, it's important to properly train them on emergency preparedness and response, as well as the different mechanisms that they would need to use in such a situation, as well as communicating the messages that are needed in such a situation. So next slide, please. Just like to say thank you to everyone who joined us today. We have two amazing presentations ahead, and I look forward to debating with all of you at the end of the webinar.
Okay. Rex, I'm still here. You're in the same office. Thank you for that. Thank you, Raquel, for this very good introduction to the topic. I will now hand over to Sara and Betsy and invite them to introduce the case on the Yemen emergency cash transfer. So, thank you, Sara and Betsy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We will be sharing about the Yemen Emergency Cash Transfer Project and looking at how that project relates to the issue of shock responsive national social protection systems. I'll be presenting today with Betty Kweyu. I'm the team leader for the project, and Betty is the ECT specialist for the project. And we'll be trying to share with you an overview of what has transpired prior to the conflict, and then what we're doing now as UNICEF in terms of intervening. Next. So in the context of war, which I think it's well known, the situation in Yemen and the fact that we have an all-out conflict across the country, but in most country contexts like Yemen, you have a collapse of the national social protection system. And in the context of Yemen, we, as UNICEF, with the World Bank and IDA, were able to leverage on the National Social Safety Net system to implement the Yemen Emergency Cash Transfer Project and actually working towards preventing a full collapse of the system. And how did we do this? I think it's very important to look at this in its totality in terms of what made it possible for UNICEF to roll out such a large-scale emergency cash transfer across the country, across Yemen. Next. Next. One more time. Next. Okay, so what we have here is sort of a timeline around what happened from the inception of the Social Welfare Fund to the launching of the Emergency Cash Transfer Project. We have the Social Welfare Fund, which is the government of Yemen's national social safety net that was established in 1996. Established in 1996, they started with about 100,000 beneficiaries who were the most vulnerable at that time. And the benefit amount was static for some time. It was adjusted in the year 2000, and the system slowly was built up, but mostly with the fiscal space, with the funding available from the government of Yemen, fully funded by the government of Yemen. And donors such as the World Bank, EU, UNICEF, actually were very supportive in trying to build the capacity and strengthen what the Social Welfare Fund was doing in Yemen. And I think for most actors, for most experts in the field of social protection, the Yemen Social Welfare Fund was definitely well known, has been well known as one of the strongest, one of the largest that was actually self-sustained by the government. The World Bank in the EU and with UNICEF around 2007 put in extra resources to really strengthen the capacity of the SWF. Around 2008, there was a proxy mean test formula applied to a significant number of households, looking at how they could sort of build confidence, more confidence in the Social Welfare Fund targeting, and looking at verifying whether or not exclusion and inclusion errors were actually true, because there were lots of feelings that there were a lot of exclusion and inclusion errors, and the donors felt it important to partner with the Social Welfare Fund to help to build the credibility of the Social Welfare Fund list. UNICEF came in with the National Social Protection Monitoring Survey later on in 2012, and that survey was important in providing evidence that the Social Welfare Fund beneficiary list was actually pro-poor, and it built more trust and confidence in that list. And I think it's important to stress all of these points, because you had a lot of work being done with the donors and with the government at the time to really hone in and ensure that you had a strong list that all had confidence in, because you had a lot of efforts being made to strengthen what was existing. And so the confidence that was built in the list led to then another exercise by the World Bank around 2012, 2013, where they started to do more work on cleaning the list and ensuring that an external firm was contracted to then work with the Social Welfare Fund to strengthen that list. So all of that was done, and you had at the end of those exercises over 1.5 million people in the Social Welfare Fund records receiving their cash through the Social Welfare Fund system. We had the onset of the war in 2015, and with the war, the Social Welfare Fund did not collapse totally. The Social Welfare Fund remained as an entity in terms of its staffing and so forth, but of course it took a significant shock, a significant hit. And in 2017, the donors then started discussing, a lot of this led by our social policy team, discussing around resuming the Social Welfare Fund. And because of the conflict context and because of the scenario around the conflict that was happening at the time and the different players and the parties to the conflict, it was decided that funding available to intervene in Yemen in the area of social safety net or social protection would not go to the government entity, but there needed to be an alternative, and there needed to be a mechanism to reach those same beneficiaries in ensuring that they continue to be supported. This led to the World Bank, with IDA funding, led to the decision to launch the Emergency Cash Transfer Project. So these investments, not only strengthened SWF's capacity, but it really built trust in the system. And when we say the system, what do we mean? When we say the social protection system or the social safety net system, because the social safety net system, which Social Welfare Fund was primary actor in, was part of the national social protection system. And that system included more than just human resources. It included and it includes actually the beneficiary database, so the targeting that was done, the human resources, the decisions around benefit amounts, the calculations around that, funding, policies and legislation, and of course then the payment mechanism. The Emergency Cash Transfer Project was a project that was intended to leverage on the Social Welfare Fund. It was intended to ensure primarily that we did not have a collapse of that system, of that social safety net system, but at the same time to have an alternative payment mechanism that will reach the beneficiaries in the fastest possible time with support. Because at that time, for the launch of the Emergency Cash Transfer Project, you had a situation where Yemen was on the brink of famine, and there were lots of concerns around the fact that you had multiple deprivations and limited resources getting to households. And so the Emergency Cash Transfer Project was set up actually to target the same beneficiary. So using the same beneficiary database, because of the confidence that had been built in that database, because of the work that had been done around that database, the database was available for easily starting up the Emergency Cash Transfer Project. The benefit amount that was set up through legislative processes that were agreed through policies and guidelines from the government, the benefit amount also was retained in starting up the Emergency Cash Transfer Project. Policies and legislation were not touched. Policies and legislation were followed for the Emergency Cash Transfer Project. So everything that was agreed as part of the Social Welfare Fund was carried forward in the Emergency Cash Transfer Project. What varied mostly, 100%, was the funding. The funding varied because the funding came from World Bank and IDA. Human resources, you'll find that we have next. I think if you click one more time, you'll see that we have some checkerboards around human resources. Because although we had fresh human resources, a lot of the service providers, a lot of the private sector organizations that UNICEF contracted leveraged the Social Welfare Fund volunteers in different communities. So although we did not use the entire cadre of the Social Welfare Fund, a lot of their volunteers were contracted to be a part of the project. The payment mechanism also was different, where the Social Welfare Fund used to use the post office, the government postal service system. The Emergency Cash Transfer Project works with the private sector banks. You'll see a little checkerboard by the payment mechanism, because one of the banks we work with also work with the Social Welfare Fund. So a lot of what used to be the social safety net system is what was leveraged to ensure the Emergency Cash Transfer Project could be rolled out in the fastest possible time. Next. There are major considerations in setting up the Emergency Cash Transfer Project. And the fact of the matter is that had there not been a Social Welfare Fund, if the systems of that social safety net did not exist, we wouldn't have been able to roll out the ECT. The first consideration was the fact that the Social Welfare Fund operated in a time when you didn't have as high a risk and the environment was not as volatile. So through building on the parameters of the Social Welfare Fund, there was a need to make sure that we had adjustments made to be able to respond to the context at the time. And in a high risk environment, definitely the modality that was used before to deliver the cash, the Social Welfare Fund, had to be adjusted. And we had to set up an alternative mechanism to deliver the cash, one that mitigated all of the prevailing risks around the country. The second consideration was around social cohesion and making sure that we operated in a manner that would not add to civil unrest or cause more conflict or do harm at the community level. And having the available targeting, having a list, pre-conflict list that was already tested and already supported in terms of cleaning by the donors, made it possible for there to be an ECT project in the shortest possible time. The ECT project from the initiation of the project in May 2017, in exactly 3 months, a project management unit was set up. The project was designed and rolled out, and the first cash was paid within 3 months. That fast, efficient ability to be able to roll out so fast across the entire country, across the entire 22 governorates of Yemen, wouldn't have been possible had there not been that pre-existing list that had already been cleaned and verified by donor support, and had we not used alternative mechanisms. And one of those mechanisms was this project management unit that I lead today, which was set up within UNICEF, a self-contained unit that actually gave us the flexibility required to be able to deliver at scale in the conflict context. Next. And if I can just share for a moment on what the PMU is. The PMU was not, in essence, the PMU was carrying out the role that the Social Welfare Fund core team used to carry out in terms of designing and implementing and monitoring the project. And the PMU actually is a self-contained unit that has all capacities within it. So as opposed to a UNICEF traditional program section that will work with other sections such as operations and so forth, the PMU has all of the operational capacity within it and is accountable at the level of the representative. And so that self-contained delivery mechanism enabled UNICEF to really roll out the project in the fastest possible time. So in delivering the project, the ECT project, we have a significant amount of reach and support to ensure that we not only maintain as best as possible the social safety net as it was prior to the conflict, without tampering with the legislative aspects, without tampering with the targeting, the benefit amount, and so forth. A lot of technical support from the World Bank and IDA was brought in, as well as UNICEF PMU sits in Jordan in Amman, but has offices across Yemen. And so working across Yemen from Jordan with technical support from headquarters in USA and Denmark, the ECT project actually has a very extensive reach in terms of technical support. And that's because the resources available within the Social Welfare Fund, some of the technical expertise within the Social Welfare Fund, given the conflict, could no longer be fully relied upon. Some are not available, some may be party to the conflict. And so to ensure neutrality of the project, this mechanism was put in place in terms of the technical support for delivering the ECT. Next. Next. So I will hand over to Betty Kweyu, who will now go through the ECT project itself in terms of what it is and how it's rolled out. If we can go to the next slide, please.
Okay. The emergency cash transfer has a national coverage. There is a beneficiary in every district, in every governorate in the country. It targets about 1.5 million and impacts a third of the population. The amount that is disbursed to the beneficiaries is the same as what was distributed before the conflict. The last cash transfer happened in 2014. It is funded by the World Bank. It's a $200 million project, which has been used to deliver cash for three payment cycles. We just concluded the last payment cycle in November. Next. This is the delivery mechanism, and it has taken into consideration the context. As we mentioned earlier, that it is a conflict context, and therefore the facilitation element brought in place to ensure that there is negotiation with the local actors to provide us access and ensure an enabling environment for the implementation of the project. The facilitation entity also raised awareness of the project to the community and also provided beneficiaries information that was essential for them to receive their entitlements, like what is required of you to receive the entitlements. We also had another component, the beneficiary support and grievance redressal, taking into consideration that the last payment was done in 2014, and the need to ensure that the right person received the entitlement. A beneficiary support and grievance redressal component was established, and it provided support to beneficiaries by, one, verifying the beneficiary's identity against the beneficiary list and with an accepted ID, and also providing a space where beneficiaries could submit their grievances. Then we had a payment agency, which was responsible for the disbursement of the cash, and a third-party monitoring entity to ensure to assess compliance to the project's procedures and standards. Next. The model has improved over time, has been reviewed based on lessons learned in the second payment cycle in order to address the inclusion barrier where those without identity cards were not able to receive entitlement. There was a community validation of identity process that was brought in, and this built on the national regulations, and those without any form of identity were able to go through a verification process so that they could also be identified and receive their entitlement. In the second payment cycle also, there was an extensive reach to beneficiaries because there were some hard to reach areas like the islands, areas that have difficult terrain, areas that have active conflict. It meant that we had to establish an outreach mechanism. And in the second payment cycle, the beneficiary support and grievance redressal component was divided to have a separate grievance mechanism where beneficiaries could also raise any grievances that they experienced through the project implementation process. In the next. In the third payment cycle, the model remains essentially the same. And there is a large number of beneficiaries that have already been verified. And therefore, the grievance mechanism and the verification now was consolidated into one mechanism. And this is the case management, which includes the grievance component. It also has a verification and a redressal component. The rest remain the same. Next. I'll hand over. Okay. And as you can see, the project, even though the amount was minimal, it had significant benefits for some of the beneficiaries because some of them were able to start some small business entities with some wise planning. In the first payment cycle, we were able to reach 1.3 million people out of the 1.5. In the second payment cycle, we reached 1.4 million. And in the third payment cycle, it was 1.38 million people. I'll hand over to Sara for the next slide. Next, please.
Next. So in closing, I think the fundamental message to share in terms of the social welfare fund, the Yemen Social Welfare Fund, and the Yemen Emergency Cash Transfer Project is that had there not been the tremendous amount of work done by the Yemeni government itself in terms of allocating resources, creating the fiscal space that was required to ensure that they targeted the poorest of the poor with the social welfare fund, reaching over 1.5 million people, had it not been done, had the systems not been strengthened, and had donors and partners not worked towards that effort in terms of really cleaning and verifying and validating the database, which could be trusted by all donors. During this conflict context where parties to the conflict were not being supported with funding for such an initiative, it would not have been possible to start up the Emergency Cash Transfer Project. And the Emergency Cash Transfer Project is a stopgap building on the existing systems, but with an intention of strengthening the humanitarian development nexus. And in doing so, there's an effort to continue cleaning the SWF database. So making sure that we continue with the verification and validation processes required to ensure we're paying the right people, given the population movement, given some of the complexities of Yemen. The SWF is not, even though you don't have it functioning as a full fund in terms of making payments to beneficiaries, the SWF is fundamental in terms of its partnership with UNICEF, and UNICEF uses its own resources for a consultative committee that works with the SWF to do joint monitoring and to provide feedback because they have the on-the-ground knowledge, they have the over a decade of experience with these beneficiaries, and so we work with them in a parallel manner, knowing that they cannot receive direct funding from the funders at this time. We work with them in a consultative way to ensure that we receive inputs from them to strengthen the project with this new payment modality. The new payment modality, the grievance redressal mechanism, the monitoring tools, the management information system, all of the mechanisms that we use now that have actually strengthened what was being done before by the SWF, is very critical for us to build capacity of the SWF so that post-conflict, they can learn and then tailor some of these mechanisms to strengthen what will be the post-conflict fund for the government of Yemen. So this is critical to the partnership we have with them today to make sure that we carry them along and that what all the good lessons that they learn from the ECT will be then used to strengthen the fund post-conflict. The SWF capacity building then goes hand in hand with that. And of course, we're looking at documentation of what is being done, what has been done to inform the eventual resumption of the social welfare fund post-conflict. And I think it's important to really hone in on the fact that this is a social safety net being implemented during an emergency period in the humanitarian space. And so in terms of the targeting and in terms of the benefit amount, looking at all of the aspects around vertical and horizontal targeting and so forth and expansion, we cannot make changes to it because this is a policy and legislative environment where the social welfare fund went through legal processes to be established. And so we cannot make changes as UNICEF and the World Bank. We're just an interim stopgap measure to make sure that the system doesn't collapse, that we keep elements of the system strong, and that post-conflict then the Yemen government will be even stronger in terms of its social protection agenda and the social safety net program. Next. Thank you.
Well, hello. Thanks so much. Yes. Thank you for the invitation and thanks so much to the attendees for joining. Today, during my presentation, I will provide an overview of the social protection system in Jordan. Also, what are the challenges that the system is facing, as well as what we are doing as UNICEF jointly with the sisters, UN agencies, development partners, and national institutions to harmonize and shift from the humanitarian context into a more developmental approach. I will turn off my camera to avoid lag during the presentation, and then during the question and answers, I will return. First slide, please. So to provide a brief overview of the country context, Jordan, it's a lower middle income country and it's the home of 10 million people, out of which 2.9 are non-citizens, including 1.3 million Syrians, of whom up to November this year, 673,000 were registered refugees at UNHCR. The major macroeconomic challenges in the country include stimulating growth and the fiscal deficit. On that sense, the unemployment rate in Jordan has reached 18.7% during the second quarter of this year, predominantly on women. There is a 10% difference between women and men. And this is the highest level in decades. Also, the recent subsidy cuts have led to an increase in food prices and at the beginning of this year. The most recent poverty data, that is from 2010, shows that the absolute poverty rate is around 14.4%, and we have 13.5% of households that are food insecure and vulnerable. Regarding the refugees, 86% of the Syrian refugees live below the national poverty line. Moreover, a third of the population is considered transient poor, with children being particularly affected by poverty. We have 20% of the children in Jordan are multidimensionally poor. This poverty incidence is higher in rural areas, but two-thirds of the poor lives in urban areas. Please, next slide. Regarding the social protection context, as you know, Jordan is considered a key and a strong player in terms of social protection in the MENA region. We can see that the Jordanian constitution guaranteed rights, access to basic social and health services for Jordanian citizens. The country has also ratified the ILO Convention on Minimum Standards of Social Protection. Anyway, there are still many conventions on employment and health care yet to be ratified to be able to align the national system with the international standards. Here in Jordan, we have many programs in place, and the government annual expenditure on education, for example, is about 3.64% of the GDP and 4.11% of the GDP in health. For the non-contributory social protection, the government is currently investing 0.94% of the GDP. Despite this, it's very important to highlight that the refugees are not eligible for any of the non-contributory programs. Therefore, most of the humanitarian assistance runs as a shadow of the national system. And that is something that later during the presentation, we will provide more details. Here, there are many players and programs on the social protection provision. There are many government ministries, such as the Ministry of Social Development, Labor, the Ministry of Islamic Affairs and Holy Places. We have education, health, finance, plus all the UN agencies, development partners, local and international NGOs. So the system faces challenges on fragmentation, coordination, limited resources, and gap and overlapping in coverage. Next slide, please. Now we will show how the system is structured. The national social protection system, it's basically structured in four pillars. We have social security, non-contributory interventions, social services, and labor market. That is for the national social protection system. When we go to the social security mechanism, this is comprised by the social security system, that this is the national pension scheme for private sector workers, employees who joined the civil service after 1995, and military staff recruited after 2002. This is a compulsory scheme where the contribution rate is set to 14.5% of the employee salaries, of which 5.5% is paid by the employee. The coverage of today is approximately 72% of the workers in the country. Here we also have the military pension system. This is regulated by the Ministry of Finance and cover the members of the armed forces recruited before 2002. Here the participants receive benefits upon a service period of more than 16 years or upon reaching the age of 60. And also we have the civil servant pension system, and this also is regulated by the Ministry of Finance and covers the government employees recruited prior to 1995. It's good to highlight that these two systems, the military and the civil servant systems, the idea is to phase out with the time, and the country will keep just the social security system. Going into the pillar of non-contributory social protection, the interventions are mainly composed by the National Aid Fund, which manages six different programs. The main one is the regular cash assistance for vulnerable families. I will provide more details later on this presentation about NAF and what we are doing with NAF. NAF also provides one-off payments in emergencies and for physical rehabilitation. Also, the NAF beneficiaries are eligible to receive free health care from the Ministry of Health. But, and this is also good to keep in mind, that refugees are not eligible to be included as part of the NAF beneficiaries. Up to date, NAF, through the main cash assistance programs, it's covering 93,000 households, and there is an expansion plan that we will talk about it later. Also, as part of the non-contributory social protection, we have the Ministry of Social Development. The ministry plays a role more related to the policy and planning aspect, and also develop small interventions to integrate community development and productive inclusion through supporting employment and skill development. Also, the ministry develops interventions on protection, specifically for children and also for some other vulnerable groups, such as disabled people. Then the third key player on the non-contributory national social protection in Jordan, we have the Zakat Fund. Zakat deliver cash and in-kind assistance through individual programs. This is funded by donation and is managed by the Ministry of Islamic Affairs and Holy Places. In theory, only households who do not receive any other benefits are eligible. And in principle, refugees are eligible, but we have not seen a lot of evidence on practice that the refugees are or have been able to access the transfers under this scheme. Please, next slide. Now, when we go into social services, and basically we will talk about education and health. On education, Jordan provides universal education, including to Syrian children. However, many schools struggle to cope with the additional school-age Syrian children living in Jordan. For example, during the 2017-2018 school year, the percentage of Syrian children enrolled at the school was around 70%. Also, many schools run two shifts of classes, often segregated by nationality. Also, there is a regulation establishing that refugee students are required to have a Ministry of Interior registration card. That regardless, during the last three school years, there have been a waiver on this regulation. It has been an obstacle for non-Syrian refugees because this waiver was provided only for Syrian refugees. So non-Syrian refugees are still under this rule. Also, on practice at UNICEF, we have seen many cases of rejections, regardless the waiver on Syrian refugees. UNICEF is cooperating with the Ministry of Education to provide additional schooling to prevent adverse effects of segregation in double shift schools. Also, we have a cash transfer program linked to education called Hayati, that during the last school year was covering 55,000 children, regardless nationalities. So the program is based on or targeted based on vulnerabilities, regardless the status of the children. Given the financial constraints, budget constraints, during this year, we had to downgrade our Hayati program from 55,000 to 10,000 children. Then also at UNICEF, we are providing capacity building activities for teachers and supporting the development of learning materials. Also, linked to education, we have our key flagship program that is Makani program. Makani program, it's a safe space to provide learning support services together with life skills and child protection services. Up to date, we have 150 centers nationwide and covering more than 200,000 children. On health, on 2012, the Syrian refugees had free access to public primary health care centers and hospitals. But on 2014, Syrians were required to pay non-insured Jordanian rate, that is approximately 35% to 60% of what foreigners paid. Then on March this year, healthcare costs increased from 2 to 5-fold for refugees. Just to give you concrete examples, for on a hospital, for example, a birth went from 85 JODs to 338 JODs, or a C-section from 300 to 800. 80%, as we said, of the refugees are below the poverty line, and therefore significant funding increases are needed to avoid the erosion of the healthcare. Regarding coverage, here the coverage of the health insurance on Jordanians, it's around 61%, but on Syrian refugees, it's around 25%. Then when we go to the labor market pillar, as we said at the beginning, the unemployment rate during the quarter three of this year was 18.7%, and mainly on women's, that is 27%, that compared to men's, it's that is 60%, it's almost 11% difference. The highest unemployment for the population with bachelor's, the highest unemployment, it's for population with bachelor and higher degree, that is 23.5%, and that is a good indicator in terms of the type of or quality of jobs available on the market. Also, it's good to highlight that 39% of Jordanian youth between 15 to 29 years found to be neither employed nor in education or training. It's around 26% males and 50% are females. So as you can see, there is a huge disadvantage on the labor market for females. Then when we go and try and see the labor market and how is the access to employment for refugees, here it requires for the refugees to have access to employment, requires the UNHCR proof of registration and the Ministry of Interior service card. Also, the work permits only cover a few sectors, such as construction, agriculture, some factories, and tourism. And this is a limitation that most of the work permits are tied to a specific employer. So if the person wants to leave that employer, then will lose the registration card or the work permit. This is do not happen on the agriculture sector, where the work permits are tied to a cooperative. In terms of coverage, from January 2016 to October 2018, 122,000 work permits were issued. Please, next slide. Now we will see how the social protection in humanitarian context is structured. As we said, there are many players on the game, mainly composed by UN agencies and national and international NGOs. And we have two operational environments for the humanitarian assistance. One is host communities and then refugee camps. And these two areas, there are three key types of assistance. It's the humanitarian assistance, the social assistance, and we have also cash for work. On this, what I would like to highlight and flag, it's how important have been this process on which, on the humanitarian side, we have been able to build the nuts and bolts and build the infrastructure for a good safety net. And there are key examples. I would like to show, and maybe as an example, the delivery mechanism for cash transfers that we have on the humanitarian context. Next slide, please. On the, for the cash delivery, we have basically already in place four key main channels to transfer money. One is through debit cards, that it's what we call ATM withdrawal. And this is most of the institutions are part of the common cash facility. The common cash facility, it's a platform used by the UN agencies and NGOs to deliver cash assistance. And through this platform is that most of the cash assistance is provided to the refugees. UNICEF, we use this interagency delivery mechanism since 2015, and currently we are co-chairing with UNHCR the Common Cash Facility, and for the disbursement of the transfer, we are using the Cairo Aman Bank. Also, we are using mobile money transfer. And this just started this year, and most of the interventions are pilot jointly with the Central Bank of Jordan. And what we are showing is that it's possible to deliver cash in the context of Jordan with mobile money. And also it's a very good tool for financial inclusion, given the regulations that exist for foreigners here in Jordan to be able to have access to a bank account. Also, there is cash in hand. The cash in hand, it's mainly at the refugee camps, given the absence of banking services and the limited internet coverage that do not allow to have ATMs or mobile money at large scale. Also, it's good to highlight and flag the blockchain model developed by WFP that have been developed at the camps, and it's showing that it's an interesting approach that would be good to explore the possibility of expanding this kind of approach. Next slide, please. Then if we go and try to summarize the key challenges that we have on the Jordanian social protection programming, the main one is how we can facilitate the shadow alignment between national systems and humanitarian systems. As I said, on the humanitarian side, we have proper system in place. We have technological innovations in place for a delivery of as a delivery mechanism, but also for example, monitoring and evaluation, for targeting. So the key challenge is how we can start transferring the know-how and the infrastructure to national systems, and how national systems could start in the mid and long term, start absorbing non-Jordanians. Also, another challenge is the ineffective coordination of social protection programs. And when I'm saying ineffective coordination, it's in terms of being able to identify overlapping between programs on both sides, on the humanitarians and also on the development, and how to cover the gaps. We have also issues with targeting. And on targeting, I may say that on the humanitarian side, there are not many challenges because we have been able to work jointly with UNHCR and also other development partners on the development and improvement of the vulnerability assessment framework. But then on national systems, there are many challenges given that each institution do the targeting using their own mechanism, and there is no harmonization on targeting. Later on the way forward, I will mention what we are doing to overcome that situation. There is no exit strategy or graduation strategy, and also the sustainability mechanism. As we can see on the main safety net of the government, that is NAF, we don't see that they have in place an exit mechanism. We have seen beneficiaries since the beginning of the program, and that they have been included without any kind of change. And also, the fifth challenge is inadequate mechanism for financing social protection. Here, we have a need to identify the budget implications of the social protection services, as well to define the mechanism to create the fiscal space to guarantee the resources without, of course, jeopardizing the stability of the economy. Next, please. Then, what we are doing as UNICEF, but and as I said, jointly with the sisters UN agency and development partners, we are working on the development of a comprehensive legal framework on social protection. In that sense, we have two key activities, that is supporting the Ministry of Social Development and the Ministry of Planning on the development of the National Social Protection and Poverty Reduction Strategy. This strategy is a 5-year strategy that will provide the framework for all social protection interventions. Up to date, we are on the process of it. We are expecting to have the first draft during the first quarter of next year. And one of the main constraints for us to be able to have the strategy on time is the lack of reliable information to establish the new poverty line, as well as to be able to identify the key indicators on poverty. As I said on the beginning, the last household income and expenditure survey developed in Jordan was in 2010. The Department of Statistics recently finished the new HACE, and we are expecting to have the key findings at the beginning of next year. And this is something that I would like to flag, that is this need of data, not just in Jordan. I think on the MENA region overall, we have the need of accurate regional poverty estimate, because and we think we must work on improving availability and access to household data, as well as collection of household data that incorporate difficult to reach population, because this will help to refine estimates on monetary poverty. For example, here in Jordan and also in the MENA region, one of the key challenges that we face in the region are that the household surveys typically do not include non-residents, and they will most likely miscount displaced residents, who are often amongst the most vulnerable groups. Also, something that here from UNICEF we are pushing is that given that context, monetary poverty may not be very informative in the presence of violent and disruptive shocks. So we should consider the use of non-monetary dimensions to provide a more complete picture of well-being. And that's why, that as a request of the Ministry of Planning, we are working also on the multidimensional vulnerability assessment of Jordan. This is a geographical mapping of vulnerabilities that will be a very useful tool to rank governorates and districts in Jordan and to use it for planning purposes. Another of the actions is to explore alternative strategies by the government to obtain additional revenue. And on that sense, the government of Jordan, as you may know, it's involved on the new income tax law. Jordan has an engagement with the IMF Extended Fund Facility Programs with the purpose of maintaining the macroeconomic stability and fiscal consolidation to reduce the debt to GDP ratio to 77% by 2021. And for that purpose, the authorities intend to rely primarily on simplifying and streamlining tax exemptions and broadening the income tax base through amending the income tax law from 2014. So the new income tax law will be running in January next year. And regardless that these additional taxes and the removal of subsidies may have a great impact in creating fiscal space, we think, however, until a well-functioning social safety net is in place, those economic measures may have a disproportionate negative impact on the vulnerable groups, which needs to be contained. Then, on the implementation of the comprehensive safety net that encompasses a productive inclusion component, on my next two slides, I will show a very brief what it's happening at NAF. Also, we think that's part of the actions that we need to enhance coordination at all levels in social protection. And on that sense, we have been pushing and we create this year the NAF Technical Working Group co-chair with the World Bank. And this working group is aimed to provide support, technical support, to strengthen the capacity at NAF, but also to support NAF on their expansion during next year. Then also, as I mentioned, we have the common cash facility, we have basic needs working groups as scenarios for coordination and planning. Next, please. Also, as we said, there is a need to enhance the social spending efficiencies. In that sense, here at UNICEF, during this year and also for next year, we have been developing budget briefs for monitoring allocations, budget allocations on key ministries. During this year, we developed the budget brief for the Ministry of Education, the Ministry of Social Development, and the Ministry of Health. Also, for next year, we will start doing an investment case to measure the efficiency and effectiveness of budget allocations, and also the development of public expenditures review and public expenditure tracking surveys, also to support the government on the planning process. Then there is a need for strengthening institutional capacity, specifically on capacity building and providing technical assistance to government institutions such as the Ministry of Planning, the Ministry of Social Development, NAF, and the Department of Statistics. And also, there is, and this is very, very important, we cannot do this without enhancing the political will. This is vital for gaining and also for maintaining the fiscal space to guarantee the financing of the social protection systems. On that sense, we are working on evidence generation which is used for the policy and development and monitoring progress towards developmental goals. We, as UNICEF, have developed child rights budget analysis for the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and NAF, and also we have been doing frequent monitoring of children in host communities as a way to being able to identify the gaps and the needs on a nationwide. Next, please. As I said, as part of the expansion of the Jordan social safety net, the government of Jordan decided to counterbalance the possible effects of the new income tax law to expand the National Aid Fund, the NAF program, by 85,000 new beneficiaries in a 3 years period. And for this purpose, the idea is to expand during next year to 25,000 new beneficiaries, and also to improve the targeting mechanism. And this is key for moving forward and being able to harmonize the humanitarian and national system. The proposal is to come with a targeting approach that could measure not just monetary poverty, also the non-monetary dimensions of poverty, and that could be used for Jordanian as non-Jordanian. So basically is to assess the socioeconomical status of the households, regardless nationalities. On practice, this have been a very tough assignment to convince the NAF to go on that direction. But the idea is that in case that the government decides that in the short term they won't allow the Syrian refugees to be part of the program, at least that we could agree on using the same targeting approach for both groups. And on that way, in the midterm, would be easier to merge both groups. Also, as part of this expansion process of NAF, all the UN agencies, also the World Bank and EU, we have come together as part of the technical working group to support NAF to start facilitating the process and transferring part of the infrastructure that we have developed for our own programs to NAF. And on that sense, we have identified five key areas that will be strengthened for the NAF expansion. And that is the delivery of cash transfer. And for this case, so far, NAF been doing the transfer cash in hand through post offices. So for the expansion, they will start using mobile money. And in fact, there is a pilot that started just 2 weeks ago. Then also supporting the systems and infrastructure, UNICEF is providing support to NAF to develop a new MIS using the know-how and the lessons learned from our MIS, the Bayanati MIS. And on that way, we have started transferring the knowledge and experience that we have gained during the last few years. Also, in terms of human resources and capacity building of the human resources of NAS, and also there is the design and implementation of a graduation strategy for beneficiaries. And finally, the communications and awareness strategy as part of the program. So in general terms, that is the social protection system in Jordan. That is what we are doing now. We are more than happy to answer any question that you may have. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Manuel. Thank you for all of you who have shared questions with us. So we have approximately 10 minutes left. So I try to have at least one round of questions. And so I will start with two questions for Sara, actually three, but Sara and Betty, but actually one of them are on the same issue. It's on the benefit amount. So Sara Hay in Lebanon asked, if the benefit was adjusted, if the benefit of the cash transfer was adjusted with inflation. And the second question in this regard is what were the reasons why the benefit amount was kept from before the crisis to the emergency cash transfers? This was a question from Marta Marzi. The second question to Sara and Betty is from Arthur, coming from UNICEF Minaro. He asked on which are the conditions that should be met to phase out the emergency cash transfer. So which are the benchmarks, which are still needed to hand it back and to make it back the social welfare funds? And one more question that is actually addressed for Raquel and Manuel. So I will ask them to ask after Sara and Betty, which is considering the volatility of the humanitarian funding and the sector as a whole, how to guarantee the rights to social protection, especially in the long term when refugees are in the same situation for long years, so as we are now seeing, as in the case of the Syrians, for example. So what are the alternatives that should be explored? So this question was also from Arthur. So I will let Sara and Betty answer for the first round, and then I will hand back to Raquel, and then thanks.
Okay, so in terms of the question from Sara and Marta on the benefit amount, the question was about whether or not any assessment was done or have we factored inflation. As mentioned earlier, one of the parts of the system that was maintained was the benefit amount, the targeting around all of that, and the policy process that was done to establish the amounts. UNICEF and the World Bank does not have the latitude during this period where you don't have one central government of Yemen with which to then go through a policy process for changing the benefit amount. What we're doing and have been advocating for, which we're very close to, is discussing with the donors for a top-up to ensure that we can provide some additional resources to the beneficiaries, but not changing what's been put in place in terms of policy around the benefit amount, because that will require a consultation process, a policy process, which right now in the conflict context is not possible. So we're looking to increase the benefit amount through a consultative process, not to increase the benefit amount, sorry, but to provide a top up to the benefit amount. And that's something that is an ongoing discussion that's in the making, hopefully can be implemented within the next two payment cycles. And then on Arthur's question about basically the conditions to be met for ECT phase out and SWF kick in, pretty much is around an exit strategy. And the truth is that we have not really come up with those parameters, with those conditions that will be required to be met before the ECT project would phase out for the SWF to resume. But that's that in the current scenario that we have with the new phase of the project, with the additional financing from the World Bank and IDA for additional payment cycles, this is one of the things that's being discussed. And we hope to define that actually with the SWF, it could be one of the ways in which we engage with the SWF around what is required for them to resume. But that's something that's work in progress. Over.
Okay. Sorry, just to address the question on humanitarian funding, I believe there's a clear interest from donors in streamlining funding for development and humanitarian purposes. And the coordination challenges are very great, particularly where these systems operate completely separately.
but I believe there's also one issue around the social cohesion and the political will, which was out of the scope of this study, but definitely deserves further research, further inquiry into, because I believe these challenges cannot be underestimated. Over to Manuel.
Yes, definitely, as based on the question of Arthur, that definitely given the short-term nature of the financing cycles on the humanitarian context, there is a need to create this fiscal space to guarantee the resources. So there have been different options proposed. One could include multi-donor trust funds with a greater focus on longer-term developmental impacts. But also on the national side, there are financing alternatives that could be explored, such as how we can increase the overall size of the country budget. That could be, as I mentioned during the presentation, through increasing tax revenue, but I'm not very agree with this option. We can start thinking on expanding the social security coverage and the contributory revenues. That's an option. Another, lobbying for increased aid and transfer. And something that I think I should mention, it's eliminating the illicit financial flows that we may see or have seen in many countries. Also, for me, the most feasible and the fastest one is redirecting the existing resources from one area to another in the case of social protections. I mean, reallocating the public expenditure and maybe tapping into fiscal and foreign exchange reserve. That could be an option, but I think that the most feasible one in the short term on national system is redirecting resources and doing this reallocation of public expenditure, making the system more efficient, and also the idea of the multi-donor trust fund, but linked to developmental goals. Over to you.
All right. Thank you. So we are almost at the end of the webinar, but I would like to have one more round of questions. So I will address, we received actually more than 10 questions, and we will try to make them all answered and available on our online community. So if you didn't have a question answered, I invite you to check the answers there later on. But handing over to one question, one more to Sara and Betty, and the last one to Manuel. On Yemen, there is a question on inclusion and exclusion errors. So because of the conflicts and all the situation that had changed in the country, how do the program, the emergency cash transfer, can deal with this inclusion and exclusion error situations, and if there is a sort of on-demand application? And the question to Manuel, actually, there are two combined questions from Charlotte Bilo. She asks about regarding the Zakim fund in Jordan and the fact that the fund is available for refugees, but the take-up seems to be non-existent. So which are the major barriers for refugees to access benefits from Zakat? And she also has asked on the integration of databases from the Zakat and the National Aid Fund, if there is any sort of data sharing agreement between the two main programs. And so hand over to Sara and Betty, and then to Manuel.
Okay, thank you very much. I will respond to the question on the demand application as to whether it was built into the program. One of the components I did discuss earlier on was on facilitation, where we had a network of offices across the 333 districts. These 333 offices also had a network that reached the lowest level of the lowest administrative level, and they communicated to the beneficiaries the project parameters, any requirements to engage with the project, as well as the payment, as well as the payment dates. And even after the third payment cycle, we still had people who had not had who had not heard about the project. So even though there was extensive communication, backed up by communication also done by UNICEF through radio, there were still some hard to reach areas which still have no contact with the program. And this is an area that we are looking at and seeing how best we can be able to reach everyone. As you can see, the target, we have met at least 90% of the target in all the payment cycles. I'll hand to Sara.
On the last question, in relation to the exclusion era in light of the dramatic change in the welfare of households, the fact of the matter is that it's true. And Yemen is a population of about 27 million people. Out of that, about 22 million of them are in need of humanitarian assistance. That's almost 82%, about 81.5%. And of those, about 11.3 million of those, around 51.4%, are in acute need. The project has a little over 1.5 million beneficiaries, reaching about 9 million people. So that's about a third of the population. That does not address all of the needs that exist. And so definitely, for sure, there have been changes in terms of the population dynamics. And this is a discussion that's ongoing in terms of how, after stabilizing the ECT project, to look at possibilities in supporting the authorities to develop a social registry down the line, to look at how, if funding is available, there can be some increase in relation to the targeting. But those are all things that are pipeline discussions for the future. Over.
Well, regarding the question on the evidence of the not refugees receiving benefits from the Zakat, I may say that here in Jordan, there is a need of supporting NAF technically and also in terms of infrastructure, regardless that in theory, as part of their inclusion criterias, they say that the beneficiaries can be regardless nationalities, that the only condition is that they should not be beneficiaries of any other program. On practice, what I have seen is that there is no proper system in place that could allow to double check if the households are benefiting or not from another program. That's one. Two, also the selection itself of a beneficiaries depends a lot on the local structure, that there is no clear mechanism on how they chose a specific household. So there is, in terms of processes and procedures, maybe there is a gap that we should find the way to support and bring them on board on this process. But that is for me the rationale for this lack of a clear process of including those beneficiaries. Over to you.
Okay. So thank you, Manuel. Thank you, Sarah and Betsy and Raquel Tebaldi, for participating today for this fruitful discussion. I'm actually personally very sad that we couldn't answer all questions, but as I said before, they will make sure that they will be online. And thank you for participating in today's webinar. Before closing, I would like to invite you to keep following the webinar series. We already have one next webinar scheduled for the 15th of January on the role of the Zakat and social protection. That we will expose the case in Sudan and Algeria, and we hope to meet you all there. And very soon, also, we have the study on shock response and social protection launched, that will be also sent to all webinar participants on a link. And next year, as also part of the series, we have a study on fiscal space for child and social protection in the MENA region. So thank you all for participating today and hope to see you soon. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.